In this lecture, we will discuss some important properties of vector subspaces. Okay, so we will put those properties in the form of theorem. The first theorem we have is this. Say, suppose I have two vector subspaces of a given vector space, then what can I say about their intersection? Is it again a vector space? Okay. So here we will prove that it's a vector space. So intersection of two vector subspaces is again a vector space of the same space, same vector space. So let W1 and W2 be two subspaces of a vector space V. Then W1 intersection W2 is also a subspace of. So first of all, we will observe that if W1 and W2 are the two subspaces of V, then by definition they have to be a subset of V, which satisfies all those 8 properties with respect to the addition and scalar multiplication in V. So if I now look at its intersection, then definitely it's going to be a subset of V. Now, to show that it is a subspace of V, we need to check for the 3 properties on this set W1 intersection W2. Okay. Now, the proof of this. Okay. Now, we will also use the basic definitions of intersection of two sets. So, we are given W1 and W2. Subspaces of V. This implies that W1 and W2 are the subset of V. By this, so to show that W1 intersection W2 is a subspace of V, first of all we need to have the intersection is a subset of V. We call a subset a subspace provided it satisfies those 3 conditions. So now we claim that this W1 intersection W2 is a subspace of V. By definition, the first thing we need to check whether the zero vector is in W1 and W2. What is given is that, okay, first of all, when do we say an element is in W1 intersection W2? If it belongs to W1 as well as it belongs to W2. Mathematically, X belongs to W1 and X belongs to W2. Then we say that X belongs to W1 intersection W2. So if I want to show that a zero vector is in this set W1 intersection W2, then by definition I have to show that X belongs to W1 as well as X belongs to W2. But that's clear from the definition of a subspace. When I say W1 and W2 are the subspaces of V, they also satisfy the first condition of being subspace, that is zero vector belongs to W1 as well as belongs to W2. Okay, so since we know that zero vector is in W1, this zero vector, I'm talking about a zero vector from V, and zero belongs to W2, as W1 and W2 are subspaces of V. If I use a shorthand notation, then the subspaces are denoted in this way, W1, this notation. Okay, this is not less than or equal to, because we cannot compare the set as a less than or equal to. So this is the notation we use for a subspace. It's slightly different than the subset. Okay, so if this is true, then 0 bar will definitely belongs to W1 intersection W2. So what we claim that this W1 intersection W2 is a subspace, and for that reason we want to show that 0 is in W1 intersection W2, and that's what we have proved. So the first one is done. Now the second one, we want to show that the addition defined on V is closed with respect to this W1 intersection W2. That is, if I collect any two elements in W1 intersection W2, then their sum also belongs to W1 intersection W2. So let me say that X and Y belongs to W1. Okay, so I'll use the fact that W1 and W2 are the subspaces of V. So corresponding second property of subspace will hold for W1 as well as W2, which means that W1 is closed under addition, W2 is also closed under addition. So this implies that X belongs to W1. Okay, in fact both X and Y belongs to W1 as well as X and Y belongs to W2. Now since X and Y belongs to W1 and W1 is a subspace, X plus Y also belongs to W1. So this is one vector. And here also, since W2 is a subspace, X plus Y belongs to W2. The reason is plus is closed in W1 and W2 being their subspace of a vector space V. Fine. So if we have a vector which is in W1 as well as in W2, then by definition of intersection, that vector have to be in W1 intersection W2. So we proved that the second property of a subspace also holds for intersection. Third one, we need to show that scalar product is also closed in W1 intersection W2. So that is, if I start with any scalar, okay, and any vector in W1 intersection W2, what I need to show is that alpha dot x also belongs to W1 intersection W2. Okay, so now this implies that X belongs to W1 and X belongs to W2 by the definition of intersection. Well, the reason I have chosen this alpha to be any real number, because we are talking about a real vector space. If it is in general any vector space, then alpha should have come from the field on which the vector space is defined. Fine. So if this is true, then definitely, since W1 is a vector subspace, the scalar product, when alpha dot x will belong to W1 as dot is closed under W1. Okay, the scalar product is closed. So here also alpha x belongs to W2. The reason is, again, W1 and W2 are subspaces of. Okay. So with this, if alpha x belongs to W1 and alpha x belongs to W2, this would mean that alpha x belongs to W1 as well as W2 by the definition. So now what do we have seen? Zero additive identity is in the set W1 intersection W2. Also, for any X and Y in W1 intersection W2, we have shown that their addition is also a vector coming from W1 intersection W2. And if we have any scalar from R and X coming from W1 intersection W2, then alpha X also belongs to W1 intersection W2. So combining this three property, I can say that the subset W1 intersection W2 of V is a subspace of. We write it as, this is always true for any two subspaces of V. Okay, now if I extend this property for an arbitrary intersection, that is, suppose I have a collection of a subspaces, collection of some subspaces of V. So I'll write down again as a theorem, let wi, okay, where I is coming from, say, some non-empty set, capital lambda. Okay. So where I'll mention that this is an index set. That means this wi, I mean, the number of elements in this collection will be as same as the number of element in this set, that is capital lambda. So this be a family of subspaces of V. Then there are arbitrary intersection. Now here this is called as arbitrary intersection because we don't know whether this set is finite or infinite. If it is finite, then you know such wi will be a finite, and so the intersection will be finite. If it is infinite, then also then the intersection will be infinite, but still. So then this intersection of all such subspaces of a given space V is also a subspace. Well, here also we strictly use the definition of intersection of such collections. So how we will go, the idea we motivate from the above proof. What basically will happen, first thing we will show that, now definitely since each wi is a subset of V, this is happening for each I coming from the index set capital lambda. So if this is true, then definitely the intersection over this index set will also be a subset. It is considered as one subset of V, right? And therefore we can check whether this is a subspace of V or not. So the first thing will definitely hold, because see, here we don't know how many sets are there, how many such subspaces are there. So we strictly refer to the index set. So what will happen, each wi will have the zero element as they are subspace of V. So therefore zero bar will belongs to wi for each I coming from index set. Now if this is true, I mean, what is the definition of this kind of set? It collects all the all such x, okay, where x belongs to wi for each, that means x is in w, I mean, suppose this set is a set of a natural number, then this wi will vary like w1, w2, wn and the so on. So suppose x belongs to, we say that x belongs to this intersection if it belongs to each of this wi. So that's the definition of this arbitrary intersection of wi. So if 0 is the element which is in each wi, by this convention we can say that 0 is in the set intersection of wi where I is varying over index set capital lambda. Okay, second property is also proved in a similar way. We strictly use the definition of such kind of intersection. So let me say that x and y belongs to the set which we want to prove a subspace, that is this set. So if x and y belongs to this intersection of wi, by definition of intersection of wi or the arbitrary intersection of such set, we mean that x and y belongs to each wi. So how do I write down this? X comma y belongs to wi for each I coming from the index set capital lambda. So if this is the case, now you know that each of this wi is a vector space. So therefore the corresponding property will be true for each wi, that is x plus y will belongs to wi for each. So we have a vector which is in wi for each I coming from the index set. So by definition This element should be in the intersection of wi, I varying over the index set. Okay, next we check for the scalar multiplication. So let alpha be a real number, as we are discussing real vector space, and x belongs to intersection of wi, the set which we want to prove as a vector space. Okay, so this by definition means x belongs to each wi, and further, since I know that alpha is any real number, alpha x will be in each wi, as a wi is a subspace. See, the reason is very clear, each wi is a subspace of V. This is a justification for every step that we have in first, second and three. And so if this is the element which belongs to wi for each I coming from the index set, then I can say that alpha x belongs to intersection of wi. So with this we are done. So from 1, 2 and 3, I can say that even the arbitrary intersection is a subspace of given vector space. Okay. Now the next question that we should have is that what about the union? Now if you are given two subsets of a set, say if I have this as a vector space V, and if I have two subspaces, say w1 and w2, see, definitely they will have at least one element common, because each element w1 and w2 contain the zero element. Okay, so the Venn diagram will always be intersect each other. So now the question is, we have already spoken about the intersection. We know that w1 intersection w2 is a vector space, vector subspace of a given V, and so it can be called as a vector space with respect to the operation plus and dot defined on this V. What about the union? Union means this entire region. Okay, what about the union? So can I say that the union will also a subspace of V? So here this is not true. In fact, we can produce a counter example wherein, you know, it says that W1 union W2 will not be a subspace of, because you know this, suppose I take an element from here, say W2, and I take one element from W1, then you know, addition of these two element may not be lying in W1 in union W2. Okay, so in general, if I have W1 and W2 as the two subspaces of a vector space V, then the union may not be a subspace. That's a general statement. That means I can produce at least one example of W1 and W2 such that the union is not a subspace. But in the above theorem, you take any vector space and you take any vector subspaces of that vector space, the intersection always have to be a subspace. Okay, no matter what is the vector space or what is the vector subspace. Okay, so we write this, we mention this as a note, and we produce a counter example here. So if W1 and W2 are two subspaces of V, then W1 union W2 need not be a subspace of V. So if you are stating that this W1 union W2, to produce an example to support this statement. So what are the examples? We will just think of some simple examples. I'll take V to be equal to R2. So let's talk about the counter example. I'll take V to be equal to R2. So R2 means we have a standard addition and scalar multiplication. You know how the addition is defined: x1 comma y1 plus x2 comma y2. The resultant vector is x1 plus x2 comma y1 plus y2, and the scalar multiplication is defined in this way: alpha x1 comma y1 is same as alpha x1 comma alpha y1. Okay. So here I'll take two standard subspaces of R2. One subspace is, that is the x-axis. You know, it forms a subspace because this is a set where the first coordinate becomes, the second coordinate is 0. So I'll take W1 to be the collection of the elements of the form x comma 0, where x is a real line. So this is a real line. Okay. And W2, I'll take it as a y-axis. So in y-axis what happened? The first coordinate is 0, the second coordinate is a real number, any real number. Okay. Then you can very easily check that this W1 and W2 are the subspaces of R2. The reason is very clear. Both this have the origin 0, 0. See, when do I say that x1, y1 or x, y belongs to W1? What is the condition on such kind of set? It collects all the ordered pair where the second coordinate is 0. So if x comma y belongs to W1, this means that y have to be equal to 0. And conversely, if there is a point in W1, then the second point, the second coordinate of that ordered pair have to be equal to 0, right? So that's the whole idea. Now if I take any two points lying on this x-axis, say x1 comma 0 and x2 comma 0, right? It's going to be of this form. When I say that say two vectors, say x bar comma y bar belongs to W1, then x bar will be of this form for some x1 in R, and y bar will be of this form for some x2 in R. Now if I add them, what by this addition, what is the resultant vector that we will get? X1 plus x2 comma 0 plus 0, that is 0. So it will lie somewhere on the real line, okay, with the real number being x1 plus x2 and the second coordinate 0. So therefore we see that the addition is closed in this set W1, and again the scalar multiplication. If I consider any ordered pair of the form x1 comma 0 for some x1 in R, then the scalar multiplication is nothing but alpha x1 comma 0, that is alpha into 0. So you get alpha x1 comma 0. So again you can see that this alpha x1 is a real number, so it will be placed on anywhere on this real line. Okay. So therefore W1 is a subspace of R2. Similarly, one can prove that W2 is also a subspace of R2. So I'll leave that as an exercise. Show that W1 and W2 are subspaces of R. Okay. So that's the first thing. Okay. Now these examples are produced to show that the union are not subspace. Okay. That W1 union W2 is not a subspace of R2. So to show that this is not a subspace of R2, what you need to show is that you need to show that at least one properties of those three properties of a subspace is not. First of all, I mean, I cannot argue with the first point. First point will always be true because 0, 0 is contained in W1, 0, 0 that's a zero element of W2. So even the union will contain this origin. So what about the second point? For the second point, if I can find a point in W1 and W2 such that the addition is neither in W1 nor in W2, then we are done. So that's a simple choice. You take 1, 0, which belongs to W1, because the second coordinate is 0 and the first coordinate is any real number. For that matter, you can even take, in fact, you can take any point other than 0, 0, okay, from the W1. Also, 0, 1 belongs to W2. So if I assume that W1 union W2 is a subspace, then the addition of these two elements should belong to W1 union W2, right? So, but if I see the addition 1, 0 plus 0, 1, which is 1, 1, 1, do not belong to W1. Why? If it was in W1, then the second coordinate should have been equal to 0. 1 is non-zero. So therefore, it is not in W1. Also, 1, 1 is not in W2. The reason is the first coordinate is non-zero. So if they are not in W1 and not in W2, definitely by definition, 1, 1 is not in W1 union W2. Okay. So they are nowhere here. They are not here as well as they are not here. So that means they are not in the union. Okay. So that's exactly the negation of definition of when we say an element belongs to union of two sets. Okay. So this is enough to say that W1 union W2 fail the property 2 and therefore it is not subspace of R. Okay, now since this is a subset, W union W2 is a subset of R2, we may put some constraint and make it a subspace of R2. So the next theorem talks about that constraint. So we will see what is the necessary and sufficient condition for the union of two subset of a two subspace of a vector space to be the subspace of R. So we have this as the theorem. Let W1 and W2 be a subspace of a vector space then I say that this is if and only if statement, then W1 union W2 is a subspace of V if and only if either of this, that is either W1 is contained in V or W2 is totally contained in V. W1 is contained in W2 or W2 is contained in W1. So either W1 is contained in W2 or W2 is contained in W1. So basically what will happen is that if W1 and W2 are placed in such a way that either W2 is contained in W1 or W1 is contained in W2, then you know W1 union W2 is a subspace of V. So let's try to prove this. So the proof of this, this is a biconditional statement and therefore we will have two parts, direct part and the converse part. So let's assume that W1 union W2 is a subspace of V. I mean, it's already given that W1 and W2 are the subspaces of vector space V. Now I assume that W1 union W2 is a subspace of V and I prove that either of this, either W1 is contained in W2 or W2 is contained in W1. So you already given this will remain fixed for both the statement to prove. Now assume that W1 union W2 is a subspace of V. What you have to prove is that either W1 is contained in W2 or W2 is contained in W1. Now we prove this by contradiction. When do we say that this statement is not true, or we prove this by contrapositive? So when do we say that this conclusion is not true? This is a statement or. So if both of the statement is not true, then we need to get some contradiction, or we need to get the contradiction to the fact that W1 union W2 is a subspace of V. Okay, so let if possible W1 contained in W2 or W2 contained in W1 is not true, which means that neither W1 is contained in W2 nor W2 is contained in W1. Okay, they are disjoint. Fine. So I'll use the definition of both this fact. So since W1 is not contained in W2, what we will have? We will be able to find at least one element in W1 which is not in W2. So this implies that there exists, say, one element W1 in W1 such that W1 is not in. Again, that's a definition of so-called as W1 is not contained in W2. What is basically W1 contained in W2 means every element of W1 is in W2. So if I can find at least one element which is in W1 but it is not in W2, we mean that W1 is not contained in W2. That's negative statement, right? And W2 not contained in W1 implies that, again, I'll be able to find at least one element in W2 such that it is not in W1. Okay. Fine. Now, since W1 belongs to W, capital W1, this implies that W1 contained in W1 union W2, right? Because W1 is a smaller set. In fact, if say any element you have in one set, then that element will be contained in the union of the subset containing that set, right? So this is always true. Also, W2 belongs to W2. This implies that W2 belongs to W1 union W2. So the reason I am getting this W1 union W2 in the picture, because I know the fact, I've assumed that W1 union W2 is a subspace of V. So what we can conclude from here is that the addition of these two vector is in the union of W1 W2. The reason is W1 union W2, this is what we have assumed, is a subspace of V. Now see what I'll show, that what is the contradiction that I'm trying to get is this. We have said that W1 is in capital W1, such that W1 is not in W2. So from here, what I can prove is that, what I'll prove is that W1 is not in W1, or in fact I can prove that W2 is in W1. So that will contradict the fact that W2 is not in W1. Okay. So we have two cases here. So when I say W1 plus W2 is contained in W1 union W2, we apply the definition. This means that the vector W1 plus W2 is contained in W1, or it is contained in W2, capital W2. Now in both the cases we should get a contradiction. So case 1, when I say W1 plus W2 is in W1, what I know is that there is an element which is not in W1, that is W2. Okay. So from here, if I can say that W2 belongs to W1, then there is something wrong. That's a contradiction. Okay. And why we are getting this contradiction? Because we are assuming that both of these statements, that is W1 contained in W2 and W2 contained in W1, are not true. Well, so how to get this? So this is case 1. Now I know that, see, that we will get from the difference of W1 plus W2 with W1, this small W1. W1 plus W2 belongs to W1. Also I know that W1 belongs to capital W1, which means that minus W1 belongs to W1 because it's a scalar multiple. So now, since W1 is a subspace, this is the fixed statement, this element plus this element will be in W1. So therefore, W1 plus W2 minus W1 will be in capital W1, which says that now W1, this, because of associativity, I can say that W2 plus W1 minus W1 belongs to W1, but W1 minus W1 is a zero vector which acts as the additive identity, and therefore I have W2 belongs to W1. This is the contradiction, because we have that W2 in such a way that W2 is not in W1. Similarly, if I discuss the case 2, wherein I say that W1 plus W2 belongs to W2, and I know the fact that W2 belongs to capital W2, which implies that minus W2 belongs to capital W2. So I add these two elements. These two elements will also be in W2, as W2 is a subspace. Okay. Here also W1 is a subspace of V. Now, if I see, if I further simplify this, then this will give me W1 belongs to W. This is the contradiction. So both this contradiction says that our assumption that W1 contained in W2 and W2 or W2 is contained in W1 is not true, is false. And therefore, we should have W1, either W1 contained in W2 or W2 is contained in W1. Now, to prove the converse way, it's very simple. We assume that W1, either W1 is contained in W2 or W2 is contained in W1. What we need to show is that W1 union W2 is a subspace. Okay, we don't follow the definition of a subspace here. In fact, it is clear from this. So if from these two statements, the first one is true. See, if W1 is contained in W2. So basically, you have this. This is your W1 and this is your W2. So what can you say about the union, W1 union W2? It is this entire set, and this set itself is nothing but W2. Why shouldn't this W2, why shouldn't this W1 union W2 should not be a subspace in this case? It has to be, because W2 itself is a subspace. So in this case, W1 union W2 is W2, which itself is a subspace, which is a subspace of V. Very simple, you don't have to use the definition. Now, even if W2 is contained in W1, now it will be just vice versa. You will have W2 inside and W1 is a bigger set. So if you look at the union of this W1 union W2, it's going to be whole of W1. So this implies that W1 union W2 is nothing but W1, which is again a subspace of V. It is given. And therefore, in both the cases, we have shown that W1 union W2 is a subspace of V. Now, to end up this session, I'll give one exercise for you all. Suppose I have two subspaces of V, W1 and W2. I define a set W1 plus W2. Okay, which will contain element of the form x plus y, where the first x, the element which is placed first, comes from W1, and the second element from the sum come from W2. The order is important. Okay, right? Then you expect this to be a subspace, right? So prove that W1 plus W2, which we have defined, is a subspace of V. So first of all, you observe that it is a subset of V, and check for the remaining three properties by applying the definition on the set which we have defined, okay? Or by applying the definition of W1 plus W2. Yeah, so with this I end up this session. Now this can be completely considered as a separate concept on the subspaces of on the result of subspaces of a vector space. Thank you.